right to shake the foundations with praise.
Praise Him.
Lord is worthy, the Lord is worthy. Today we got a right to shake the foundations with praise.
Glory,
glory, hallelujah.
This is what we come to do.
This is what we come to do. Tear down strongholds, break the chains. Bind the devil in Jesus' name.
Today.
Shake the foundations with praise.
Praise Him.
Praise Him. Praise Him.
The Lord is worthy.
The Lord is worthy. The Lord is worthy. The Lord is worthy. The Lord is worthy.
Today.
Today we got a right to shake the foundations with praise.
Praise Him.
The high places.
we're gonna tear that devil's kingdom down. Hallelujah, we worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. We're here to do to trample the serpent under our feet. Hallelujah. And lift up the name of Jesus. Amen. Whose report are you going to believe?
Hallelujah.
We're going to believe the report of the Lord. Because his report says, I am healed. His report says, I am filled.
Hallelujah.
His report says, I am free. And his report says, victory. Victory. Amen. Whose report will you believe?
We shall believe the report of the Lord.
Tell me, whose report will you believe?
We shall believe the report of the Lord.
His
report says, I am healed. His report says, I am filled. His report says, I am free. His report says, a future and a hope, an expected end. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. We come here with humble hearts this morning. Father, we want you to have your way, O God, this morning as we humble ourselves in your sight. Let it, Lord, not be just today. Lord, let it not be just on a conference day, Lord. Father, that we would be excited every morning. Father, we would be excited, Lord, to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God in your sight, Lord, every day of the week, not just today. So we, Lord, we ask that you would have your way this morning as we humble ourselves, expecting, oh God, something great and mighty today.
Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord. Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord.
Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord.
And he shall lead thee higher, and he shall lead you.
Hallelujah. Let that be your prayer this morning as we enter in, as we prepare our hearts. Hallelujah.
Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord.
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 Hallelujah.
praise you, Lord. We praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We worship. Hallelujah, we worship you, Lord. Give us some praise in the house. Lift up your name,
just
to
praise.
Jesus. Focus on the King of Kings.
Praise
Lord,
through
we
it.
Worship
praise
you,
through
Jesus.
It. Hallelujah.
Oh, we bless yes, you, Lord. Jesus. Hallelujah.
We thank you, Lord,
we
for what you're going to do here today,
name.
Oh God.
We bless you,
Lord. Oh, we bless your name, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
We thank you, Lord, that you are in control. We thank you, Lord, that you are mighty God. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh, we thank you, Lord.
How many know? The devil is a liar.
Song, I think we all know it really well. I believe that it's just going to set the stage this morning, because it's more love, more power, it says. And you know, I don't know about you, but I want more love and more power from our Heavenly Father this morning, because it says, do you want more love, more power, more of you in my life? That's what the song says. Amen. Sing that, and I think a lot of you know that. And it's the males kind of do it, and they go, more love, and then the women come in, more love. I don't think I have to teach you that this morning. But we're going to do that this morning. We're going to set the stage for the Holy Spirit to have his way.
Amen.
We're not going to allow distraction. We're going to not allow any static in the sound system to distract us this morning. We're going to believe God. He's so great and mighty. Hallelujah. More love.
Oh, Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. How many know that devil is a liar? Amen. God's word is still going to go forth in this house. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm just being sensitive to the Spirit of God this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We have a great lineup of speakers this morning. I want to hear what the Spirit of the living God is saying to the church in this hour. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. I am so excited. I've been so excited all week. I could just hardly wait, like a little kid, just like waiting to go to a party. You know, it's been great. Okay, well, I'm going to introduce our first speaker. Let me tell you a little bit about him first before we welcome him up to the pulpit. Dr. Gene Cate. He was my pastor for several years. He's an awesome man of God. Okay, he's an awesome man of God. He's a man who moves mightily in the prophetic. And he's dead spot on. Hallelujah. He's a consultant to the fivefold ministry. And I respect him greatly. He's been a conference speaker. He holds a doctorate. And he's my friend. So let's give him a warm welcome, Dr. Gene Cate.
Dr. Kerry Woods just informed me that I've lost 10 minutes off my time. So I'm taking 10 of his. Hallelujah. Glory to God. All right. Well, we have three subjects that we are going to attempt to give you the Reader's Digest condensed version of. And I got tasked with the very narrow subject of the kingdom. And Pastor A says that I can get this done in 30 minutes. So given the circumstances that I find myself in, I said, Holy Spirit, you're going to have to help me nail this one, okay? Or otherwise I'm going to mess this thing up. So let's turn in our Bibles, if you have them with you, if you need to download it or whatever it is you upload, whatever you need to do, to Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 through 13, which I think kind of sets the stage for where we're going today. Matthew chapter 6, it says, "In this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." So, Father, I just offer this short prayer. Holy Spirit, help. Help us. Bring forth a word from your throne, God, and give us ears to hear what the Spirit would say to the church. The kingdom, yours is the kingdom. Just to kind of break it down really simple here, who was Jesus referring to when he said yours? Our Father. Our Father. You got to connect with the Father if you're going to connect with the kingdom, because it's his. Amen. He's the author of it, and it's going to be delivered back to him through the Son. Hallelujah. As I was praying about this, really what I kept hearing the Father speaking to me about was kingdom relationships. I mean, we could take the kingdom in all of its many facets and spend months talking about it. But what I feel the Holy Spirit wanted to say to this gathering this morning had to do with relationships and also the role of the apostolic and prophetic where this is concerned. Because the apostolic and prophetic ministry do have a significant role in the kingdom. Amen. Jesus referred to them as the keys of knowledge. He told Peter, he says, I'll give you the keys of the kingdom. Keys represent access. Amen. And so the apostolic and prophetic ministry was given to the church to give us a unique access into kingdom reality. Now, I believe very strongly in the and one of the foundational doctrines of the church is the priesthood of every believer. We all have access to the Father. We all have, you know, we don't have to go through anyone to approach God or to hear from God. How many of you believe that? However, at the same time, God never intended for everything to come to us just directly and independent of others in the body. So there's a relationship that is vital between us and the Father through intimacy with Him, but also through relationship with others. And I believe that if we're going to come into the fullness of all that the kingdom has to offer, we need to have ears that are dialed in to His servants and His handmaidens in this hour. We need to hear from the prophets. We need to hear from the apostles. That's why it seems that the church, you know, we've kind of gone through the era of the restoration of the pastoral gift and the teaching and the evangelists, and I love those gifts. I really do. I remember I came up in the Word of Faith camp, you know, many years ago. I mean, if you weren't a teacher, you just weren't happening. You were not happening. Amen. But at the same time, I love the evangelist. I never will forget a meeting I went to in Gatlinburg with Brother R.W. Shambach. Amen. And love that guy. Love those happy clappy camp meeting songs. Amen. It turns me on. And I wanted to be an evangelist. I get around evangelists. They charge me up, man. They really do. They draw something out of me. You see, in each of us, each believer, I believe, has a fivefold hunger on the inside of you, that in times and seasons in your life, God will use different aspects of the fivefold ministry to address that hunger, because in that time and season, He's going to be speaking to you in that certain way. What we have to be careful of is that we don't get stuck in a certain soulish fivefold addiction, that if this person's not a prophet, you're not going to listen to them, or if this person is a prophet, you're not going to listen to them, whatever your perspective is, amen. Glory to God. And if you can't take notes on His message, then I challenge you to take notes here today, brother. Good luck with that. That's all I got to say. But what's this got to do with the kingdom? Well, first of all, we have to understand where is the kingdom? It's in heaven and in earth. He says, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven." It's always been the heart of the Father to extend His kingdom, amen, in out of eternity into time. Out of the realm of the spirit and into the realm of the natural. And how many of you know when the kingdom manifests and comes forth, birthed through the power of the Holy Spirit through upon His people, when that kingdom is manifest, there is a violent reaction that takes place in the natural, amen. Because unfortunately, this natural world is under a lease at this point in time, amen. And because when the kingdom actually began here on earth in the garden. Goes all the way back to Genesis, amen. The problem is that kingdom dominion was given to someone that did not steward it properly, and it was given over to someone else. Now, does that mean that the kingdom was lost? No, it just means we kind of had to, as we were talking about the sound system a while ago, sometimes you just got to reboot. Even the garden itself was a realm of the kingdom, where Adam and Eve would be charged with the responsibility of extending the fruitfulness and character and essence of that garden into all the world. So be fruitful and multiply. What was surrounding that garden? What was surrounding that garden was that demonic realm that had fallen into the earth. But here, I mean, the idea was, oh, we're just going to camp here in the garden. No, we're going to extend the rule of the garden. Amen. We're going to extend this kingdom. It's always been the vision of God for the knowledge of the glory of the Lord to cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. Revelation 11:15 says, then the seventh angel sounded, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. So we see in one end of the book, it looked like the kingdom got sabotaged, but then we see at the other end of the book that the kingdoms of this world become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. And you know what stands between Genesis and Revelation? It's a covenant people in covenant relationship with the kingdom through our elder brother, the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You see, the fathers had the kingdom from eternity past. It's the heart of the father to give. It's the heart of the father to share. And what's his heart to share it with? His family. His family. So the kingdom speaks of relationship. And in the father's heart is to entrust that kingdom. Amen. For it to become our legacy. For it to become our inheritance. So we need to have we need the voices of the apostolic and the prophetic, amen, to clarify and to bring into focus the things of the kingdom, particularly in this time and season that we're in, amen. There is a company of people that God is raising up that are as the sons of Issachar, who knew the times and the seasons. You see, we have the eternal word of God through the Bible, through the scriptures, but the word of God is the same, amen, from generation to generation, from season to season. But how many of you know that there is a specific rhema word for each time and season that we're in? One of the things the Lord has shown me recently, that for 2017 was going to be there was going to be an increased manifestation of the sons and daughters of God in the earth, that there's going to be a greater manifestation of the character of God in us and the power of God, and also a greater manifestation of our purpose. We're going to come into a greater understanding not only of who we are, but why we are. Both are important. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You see, the redemption story from Genesis to Revelation is the story of God's plan to share his kingdom beyond the realm of eternity into the realm of time in covenant partnership with man. As I said before, the heart of the Father is to share the kingdom with his family. Yes, I believe that the kingdom is about healing. It is about setting the captives free. Jesus told him, he said, freely you receive, freely give. Go and preach the kingdom. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead. Those are manifestations of the kingdom. But folks, there's more to the kingdom than just that. That's part of it. But there's got to be some foundations in place out of which that administration of the kingdom power and authority can be administered correctly and properly in the earth. And it must be administered in the context of relationship. First of all, intimacy with the Father. Intimacy with the Father. I love the power of God. I really do. I love miracles. I love healings. I love the prophetic. I love all those things. But it really just kind of irks me when somebody can move in power in 1 minute and be as mean as a snake the next. I don't know if they're laying hands on me because they want to get me healed or if they just want to slap me around. I remember in the early days of my walk with God, I was in a Pentecostal church revival, and as a young Baptist boy, went down to have hands laid on me to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Those people about kill me, trying to get me filled with the Holy Ghost. And I ended up not needing to be filled with the Holy Ghost. I needed to be healed. And some of them white-haired Pentecostal grandmas, man, they're tough. Smacking me in the chest, smacking me on the head. Thank goodness they finally got tired. But he wants to give the kingdom to his family. Luke 12:32 says, "Do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." Notice he said little flock. Little flock. God's not afraid of numbers, but he's not dependent on them either. He'll give the kingdom to a little flock. A young flock. And even an immature flock. And when I say immature, I'm not talking about being childish, but what I am talking about where we walk in such a way of childlike dependency on the Father, where we hear clearly the cry of the Spirit in our hearts that cries out, Abba, Daddy. Well, we have that, it's that love relationship that we have with the Father. It's in that context that a greater manifestation of his kingdom will come into the earth. We need the power, and we need the love, and we need more both. Amen, Pastor Monica. Oh, hallelujah, brother! I'm glad you came out with that one, man. Okay, I got to move along. The purpose of the apostolic and prophetic ministry is more than planting churches and establishing ministries. Their purpose, number one, is to reveal the heart of the Father in such a way that people will want to know him intimately. It's more than just information. There's an impartation that comes. There are those spiritual parents, if you will, that God is raising up, not to dictate to us, not necessarily to say, okay, step one, step two, step three, but also to model for us where they walk with such love and intimacy with the Father that, man, you just want to know God like they know God. And they have the wisdom to know that intimacy with the Father is not going to come just by laying on of hands. I cannot impart to you my history with God. You got to write your own history with God. But I pray that my history with him will be so evident that it makes you hungry to start to write your own journal with the Father. And that's what God is raising up. Not just teachers, not just preachers, but people that will model the character of the Father. The first step to encountering and manifesting the kingdom is to be intimately connected with whom Paul referred to as the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named. Number two, to model the heart of the Father by nurturing spiritual sons and daughters in the ways of the kingdom, that in turn they will manifest the glory of the kingdom to their culture and bring kingdom transformation. The ways of the kingdom. When we show people the ways of the kingdom, they'll give us permission to introduce them to the King. Amen. And then thirdly, to build up the family of God by being examples and catalysts of unity and connectivity. Unity is more than just getting along. How many of you know you can have unity and sometimes you don't get along? But you don't run away and avoid the not getting along. You make a covenant commitment to work through it. You work through it. How many married folks we got in here? Hallelujah. How many of you know that not every day and every moment of your marriage is a honeymoon? How many of you know there are some issues? And guys, let me tell you something. We're the best avoiders in the world. We really do. We avoid those tough conversations. But I want to tell you something. Ladies, you have a way of bringing us into reality. Where we're going to have this conversation. And we're going to have it right now. I believe one of the things that we're going to see in the body of Christ is those that don't get along start to have dialogue and say, listen, I don't like you, but I need you. So let's work this out. You say, Gene, you're getting pie in the sky on me here. No, I'm just telling you that's where the rubber meets the road. Tough conversations sometimes happen in the family, but they happen because we love each other and we know that the relationship has to have those conversations, that dialogue. Amen. I don't know where I'm getting off on that, but what I'm saying is this: we don't need to avoid those that differ from us. We don't need to avoid them. And we also don't have to have the attitude that it's our responsibility to change them. Our responsibility is to love them. The apostolic and prophetic ministry must be clothed in the spirit of Elijah and turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the children to the fathers. The father's heart burns for his family. Let me tell you something. The father's not trying to build a kingdom. He already has a kingdom. Ain't nothing wrong with his kingdom. Amen. He's not trying to fix it. It ain't broke. He wants to share it. And the amazing thing, he chooses broken people to share it with. In fact, he says, I'm near to those that are brokenhearted. How many of you know that the church in Pasco and Pinellas County is broken? Amen. But he doesn't discard it. He chooses to use it. Amen. And he challenges us not to avoid our brokenness, but address our brokenness, recognize our brokenness, and come to a place where we say, God, you know, I'm broken. How many know the root word of broken is broke? Like I told somebody one time, I'm too broke to change my mind. Broken. It comes from a place of dependency. The kingdom belongs to those that are poor in spirit, where we're dependent, amen? Where we're dependent on the Father. And not only dependent on the Father, we're dependent on the family. I don't always like my family, but I need my family. And there's never a more devastating time you'll ever find yourself in when you find yourself isolated from family. That nothing is more destructive, more deadly than that. So the kingdom, the manifestation of the kingdom for this hour is the bringing together of the family, of the father-child relationship and the inter-family relationship, that connectivity through which kingdom authority and kingdom power will be demonstrated and is being demonstrated. And folks, I'm not talking about something down the road. I'm talking about something going on right now. It is happening. It is happening. God is looking for a household who will carry in its DNA the essence of all the kingdom is: righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost, and power. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me pray for you. Father, as we come here today, Lord, we come here, Father God, as your children, Lord, your little flock, of whom you said you greatly desire. It's your good pleasure to give us the kingdom. So, Father, I pray that in this time, Lord God, that you would deliver to each and every one of us a greater measure, a greater understanding, a greater insight, Lord, of not just the knowledge of your kingdom, but the passion that you have to give us the kingdom, Father God. Father, we need that passion right now. Lord, you're passionate for us, God. We need to be passionate about you. Lord, you're passionate about your kingdom, Lord God. We need to be passionate about that too, Father God, of embracing that and manifesting that in the earth. So, Father, I just pray, Lord God, as we continue in this conference today, Lord God, that you will release your apostolic and prophetic men in this time, Lord God, to declare all the things of the kingdom that we need for this time in this hour. Raise up a kingdom family. Raise up those apostolic and prophetic voices, Lord God, in this region, in this nation, Father God, that your sons and your daughters, Father God, would be the manifest sons and daughters, Lord God, that all of creation is groaning for in this time, Lord. Father, I thank you for this time that we're living in this country, where revival is springing up and your kingdom is being manifest. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Yowza, yowza, yowza. That was great.
Hallelujah to the Lamb. I'm going to bypass the 10-minute break, okay? So I'm just going to keep on moving along. This ship is moving along to the next port now, okay? At this time, I'd like to give you a little information on our next speaker. Our next speaker is Dr. Kerry Wood, and he truly is an apostle, and he has planted many churches. He's also an author, and we have his books back on the table, and I really suggest that you buy one because they're awesome, amen? And his lovely wife, Cheeky, also has authored a book, and their books are back there for sale. Okay, he is a pastor at Gateway Church in Dallas. Powerful church. How many know Robert Morris? That's your pastor, right? Yes, that's your pastor. And he is an overseer of Equip. And well, he would like to hear a little bit more about that equipping thing that you do. Okay. He's also a professor at King's University. He holds a doctorate of ministry. And he's a very dear friend of mine. So please, let's give him a warm welcome.
Thank you. Now, I'm convinced that the one reason that I worked so hard to get the doctorate was so I could come speak in this conference. Because, you know, Pastor April says she's got her docs in a row this weekend. Dr. Cheeky last night. That was excellent. That was excellent. And then this morning, wow, fantastic. So if you aren't with us last night, I'm not going to go back and try to explain that, but how many of you know the Holy Spirit has a sense of humor? He can be funny. And he gave me a word last night that was too funny to share. It was simply too funny to share. He says, "Welcome to Cornelius's house." Everybody know who Cornelius was? The Italian captain. He said, "Welcome to Cornelius." We had just eaten sausage and pasta and meatballs and Man, oh man. And then the Spirit of God just come through that place. He said, welcome to Cornelius' house. This is what it was like. Loaded up with pasta and full of the Holy Ghost. It doesn't get any better than that. I'm telling you, it just doesn't get any better. Fantastic. I have written this book because as I teach at the King's University and Shiloh University, I've met many, many young people in their 20s that have never been exposed to the gifts of the Spirit. They've never been exposed to the Holy Spirit. They've never heard Catherine Kuhlman or Amy Simple McPherson or T.L. Osborne or any of these guys. They don't know who they are. And as I'm teaching and I say, do you know who Oral Roberts is? And a blank look comes over their face. Do you know who Catherine Kuhlman is? Blank look. They don't know what I'm talking about. Never been on MTV, so they don't know who they are, you know. And so I begin to survey those students and ask them questions about the Holy Spirit, why we need the Holy Spirit. Do you understand the gifts, why we need the gifts? And about a 25-page appendices of this book is their questions and answers and then my responses to those. And the second chapter, by the way, just fits hand in glove with what we've just heard. Second chapter is the gifts of the Spirit as God's compassion. And we'll talk about that just a little more in just a minute. Paul says the kingdom of God is not words, but power. And so my assignment this morning for the next few minutes is the kingdom of power. The kingdom of power. And so we want to just demonstrate that a little bit, not just talk about it. How many of you like to see demonstration of the Spirit? So I'll tell you just a little bit of my experience. I grew up in a Pentecostal church in the Assemblies of God. My childhood pastor was T.L. Osborne's sister. How many of you know who T.L. Osborne is, or you've heard about him or read his books? Okay, so how many of you have heard of Reinhard Bonnke? Okay, a little more. Well, T.L. Osborne was the predecessor of Reinhard Bonnke. Before Reinhard Bonnke was traveling the world and packing out stadiums and 50,000, 100,000 people, T.L. Osborne was doing that, primarily in Africa, France, Albania, places like that, Algeria. And his sister was my pastor. Now, let me tell you something about her. She had the same anointing that T.L. had, but she functioned as a pastor of a local church. And then she'd go out once in a while, and she would do evangelistic meetings. And so one of those meetings in Oklahoma, she is preached, and then she calls for people to come forward if they need healing or ministry of some kind. And this 10-year-old boy comes forward. Some of you have probably read the story. You can look it up. You can Google it, YouTube it. The boy's name was Ronnie Coyne. Ronnie Coyne came up because he had contracted pneumonia because he'd been on his back in the hospital for 6 weeks. And so he had just gotten out of the hospital, and his mom brings him up to the front to get prayed for. So Sister Gillock's praying for people. She comes to this boy, and she just sees his eyes don't look the same. One eye looks different than the other. And so she just simply says, I don't know what it is about your eyes, but we're going to pray total healing. And everybody in the room went, because what they knew that she didn't know was that this little boy had gotten his eye poked out from a friend swinging a wire. The eye had gotten infected. They had to take that eye out and put a glass prosthetic eye in. He had been on his back in the hospital for 6 weeks with that thing healing. He's standing there with one glass eye and one real eye. And she just sees they don't look the same, so she says, that's not right, let's pray. She puts both thumbs on the eyes, hands on the side of his head, and says, sight in Jesus' name. And the boy opens and says, what? Okay, you're not going to believe this, but I grew up seeing this every year because Ronnie Coyne, by the time I was a child, Ronnie Coyne was in his 30s, now he's preaching. He would come to our church, Sister Gillock's church, T.L. Osborne's sister. He would come to our church, he would preach, he'd pop out the glass eye, stick it in his pocket. He would open up the empty socket, walk around the building, make sure everybody could see it. Now you can imagine, I'm a 10, 12-year-old boy. I'm just... My dad was one of the men that would take the handkerchiefs, put it on here, and they would tape up his head where there's no way he could see out of his good eye. And he'd say, bring me the smallest print you can find. People, because he'd come every year, people would bring... They would know he's coming. They'd get little pencils. They'd get little fine print on business cards to bring it up. And he could read. He says, it's no different than being able to see out of the palm of your hand. It's a perpetual miracle. God can use an optic nerve or he cannot use an optic nerve. He can give you sight any way he wants to. That was a perpetual. I grew up with that. I grew up seeing healing. I grew up seeing miracles in my life. And so years later, fast forward, I'm preaching in the capital of the Republic of Georgia, just south of Russia. And I've been ministering all week, teaching the pastors how to move in the gifts of the Spirit, how to minister healing, et cetera, et cetera. So I said, tonight, teaching them in the daytime. Tonight, I'm going to do a short 30-minute thing on, realize I said 30 minutes short. I'm going to do a short 30-minute thing on ministry of healing. Then I'm going to lay hands on all of you pastors, and then we're going to invite people to come. So I do that. I preach short, 30 minutes, and then I go down to the front. I'm telling the people, I'm going to call these pastors down. I'm going to lay hands on them, not because I have something they don't have, but I just want you to see that there's a transfer of anointing, and you're going to receive. Well, while I'm explaining that, this man stands up. He's got this kind of long, lanky boy in his arms, too big to be carried, but he's carrying him up to me. Now, this isn't protocol, right? I'm supposed to lay hands on the pastors first, and then the pastor can lay hands. This guy just gets up and comes up to me. While he's coming, I look at my translator. I say, what's going on? He says, well, everybody in this church knows that this boy was born blind. I said, okay, this is going to be really good or really bad. Right? So he comes up to me. Everybody's watching. I haven't laid hands on any of the pastors. And what do you think I see? I see my pastor as a child putting her thumbs on that boy's eyes and say, be whole. I put my thumbs on that boy's eyes the same way my pastor did. I said, be whole in Jesus' name. And all of a sudden he went, lights, lights. It was in Georgia, but lights, lights. He began to point out the lights, and the whole place erupted, and you didn't have to lay hands on any pastors. I mean, it just that way. When I was a youth pastor, I'm not telling you this because what I'm telling you is every one of us have the authority in Jesus' name to release the power of the King. You might want to write this down. Henry Blackaby says, the kingdom of God is the effective range of God's will. The kingdom of God is the effective range. You see, God's will is not being done everywhere, but it is being done where his presence is being carried. The kingdom of God is the effective range of God's will. Or Dallas Willard says it this way, the kingdom of God is where what God wants done gets done. So I'm a youth pastor. This is years ago. It was, I rode my horse and buggy to the church. Youth pastor, we take our young people up to Colorado between Christmas and New Year's every year when I was working with Bob Nichols in Fort Worth, Calvary Cathedral. And I've got one young guy, his name's Greg Pope, and he's the adventuresome one. And he's the only one I've ever seen flip a go-kart on his head. You know, I mean, if there's going to be something go wrong, Greg's going to be in the middle of that. So after our evening meeting, we go up the bunny slopes, and we ride inner tubes down. Well, he decides to take his inner tube down around a side slope, not knowing he doesn't have a steering wheel on that inner tube. And he takes the inner tube off the side, hits a tree, breaks his thigh bone in two places. We carry him down to the lodge, and we've got two nurses with our team. And we're looking at him laying there, and his leg looks like a Z, literally. Clear break, two places. We're waiting for the ambulance to come. So, you know, I'm young. I've been raised in the supernatural. It was normal to me. I just said, let's pray. Let's call for healing. All these young people lay their hands on him, and I'm not stretching it at all. Everyone of them in that room would tell you the same story. As we were laying our hands on Greg's thigh, waiting for the ambulance, we heard, pop, pop. Everybody looked up, and his leg was perfectly straight. Ambulance finally came. They took him, did x-rays. No break, couldn't even see a fracture. There was only a bruise. There. I'm not telling you that happened to me. That happened with a bunch of teenage kids that just believe God. Just believe God. Now, power works in a lot of ways, not just in healing. It can work in getting someone elected that has no way of ever getting elected. Right? Now, I'm not talking about this last election. It could be 8 years ago. I don't know. Whatever, you know, that's not a political statement. It can stop rain. It can start rain. When I was in Bible college, I was working parking cars at the Oz in Dallas. And the way that thing works is everybody comes in all at once. You have to park the cars. You run yourself crazy, get them all parked. They go in there and they party and they eat. And they all come out once. And if you're not ready for them to come out, you don't make any money that night, right? And so we're standing there and I see a rain cloud, a wall of rain coming towards the restaurant. My buddy and I, both of us, deep in the Word of Faith movement at that point, just learning how to use our faith. And we see this rain of water, and all we know is we're not getting paid tonight if that rain gets on our parking lot, because we had half of it was dirt. And we had Maseratis, we had Alfa Romeo, we had all of them there. And so we just stepped out on parking. We said, you will not drop a drop of rain on this property in Jesus' name. That's all we said. You don't have to believe me, but I was there. I saw it. I saw the wall come as it got to I-635, Luke 635, and it split, and it went around both sides of that property, and not a drop of rain on our property. Now, that, listen to me. That's not Moses trying to get the people across into the wilderness. That's just two guys needing to make a living. That's just two college boys trying to get through college, but learning how to partner with God. God cares about where you are. He cares about the big stuff. He cares about the little stuff. Now, I know you know this because you're taught well, but you know you can't find a place in the book of Acts where they prayed for the sick. Oh, got quiet. What? There's lots of healings in Acts. Yes. But go look and see if you can find any place where they prayed. Jesus didn't say go pray for the sick and they'll recover. He said heal the sick. Even in Mark chapter 16, I just went back and looked at it, make sure that I read it right. He doesn't say pray for the sick. He says these signs shall follow them that believe. They'll lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. You will not find one place in all the book of Acts where anybody prayed for the sick. They simply spoke, or they reached out and laid hands on, or they pulled them up. They declared, and the authority of the kingdom released a power that drove the sickness out. Now, we're coming to activation point. I want you to stand up where you are. Is there anybody in the room that's not 100% well? Now, understand, the power of the kingdom is more than just healing. We've heard that. We understand that. But we need to manifest that, understand that that's something you don't have to pray your way up to. You don't have to, oh, I'm not feeling just really holy this morning. I heard something on the radio, kind of a great joke, you know, and I don't feel totally clean, so I don't guess the Lord can use me today. If you're a son, daughter of God, walking in a spirit of sonship, then the authority and the power of the name of Jesus flows through you even when you don't feel like it. That doesn't give you a license to not live a holy, sanctified life. But when things aren't going just right, how many of you know the king is still the king? And his presence is still available. So let me just see a hand. Anybody, if you think I'm going to pray for you, I'm not going to pray for you. You're going to pray. You're not going to pray. You're going to declare the authority of the king. Anybody that needs healing this morning, you're just not 100%. Whatever it is. Okay, hold it up real high. Okay, that leaves a lot of praying, not praying, declaring for the rest of us. I'm trying to make the distinction for you over and over again. All right, let's do it this way. All the men that aren't 100%, you got your hands up, keep them up. All right, this is what I want to ask you to do. I've seen this. I've done this many times. Every time, even though I teach it, we fall into the default. I'm going to have you turn around and release the authority of the king to heal that person. I don't want you to close your eyes. I don't want you to talk to God. I don't want you to pray. I've seen this happen over and over again, and you know it'll happen again here. Somebody, just by automatic default, will go, oh, God, you know how good they are. You know, God, heal them today. Heal them, Lord. Jesus never said pray. He said, I have given you the keys. You go, lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. Okay, hands up. Men that need healing. Men, just the men that need healing. All right, two or three of you, just around those. One of you take the lead. Keep your eyes open. Put your hands on their shoulder. And just declare, in the name of Jesus, I command healing power to flow from the top of your head to the soles of your feet. Don't close your eyes. Don't pray. Declare to him. Look at this body. Declare healing power in Jesus' name. I command every organ, every system, every cell in this body to receive resurrection life in Jesus' name, from the top of your head to the soles of your feet, in Jesus' name. Now, everybody that just received that, just say, I receive that. I receive that now in Jesus' name. All right, all the ladies, you're just not 100%. We don't have to go into the doctor's diagnosis, but you just like for the king to come touch you. All the ladies, okay. All right? Now, guys and ladies that don't have the hands up, turn around and do the same thing. Do not close your eyes. Do not pray. Do not talk to God right now. You're talking to their body. You're commanding every organ system and cell in their body to receive resurrection life by the authority of the King who is present in this room right now. All right? Who's got their hand up? Don't have somebody around them. Okay, come right here. Okay. Okay, you got two over there. You come around here. Guitar player right here. All right? Everybody got somebody? Need somebody right here. Who doesn't have somebody? Right there. Come around front. I want to ask you, okay, here's another thing. I'm just trying to get you to think. If you're talking to their body, you're not talking to God, you're talking to them, you're talking to their body. Don't stand behind them. Get around in front. Keep your eyes open. And this is what I want you to declare. In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to receive healing power and healing life. I command every organ, every system, every cell, don't close your eyes, open your eyes. Every organ, every system, every cell receive life in Jesus' name. Be whole in Jesus' name. Be whole in Jesus' name. Open your eyes. Be whole. Talk to that body. Be whole. If the Lord tells you what organ it is or what it is, just speak it out. Command you to be whole. Command the neurological system, be whole. Skeletal system, be whole. Circulatory system, be whole. Pneumatic system, be whole. In Jesus' name. All right. How many of you fell into praying there? How many of you closed your eyes, started praying? Okay, we won't admit it, but you know, that's what we do. I'm just trying to get you one step over. You see, the distance between, don't sit down just yet, the distance between the natural and the supernatural is less than paper thin. It's as near as your heart and your mouth. You're carrying the supernatural as a spirit being. You're carrying the presence. How many of you know the Holy Spirit, the third member of the Trinity, lives inside of you? He has taken on humanity as his suit. You carry him everywhere you go. All you have to do is release him. I declare healing, working in your body right now. In Jesus' name. All right, how many of you, just check yourself, how many of you feel something that's changed? Just check yourself. You feel something. You might need to move something around. Feel something. All right, raise your hand if you feel something has changed, okay? Like last night, prayed for these eyes, and she opened her eyes, and she said, wow, that's a beautiful necklace you're wearing. Are you wearing pearls? Yeah, that's pearls. And then she began to call out the colors on Cheeky's dress. Okay, that, there's a progressive thing. Some things happen instantaneously. Some things happen progressively, but they're happening right now. Okay? How many of you, you just, something changed, you feel something, the pain is gone or diminished? Yeah? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So let's y'all just praise the Lord for his presence. Just give him thanks. Lord, thank you. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your healing power. Thank you for your glory. Thank you for working in Jesus' name. All right. You can be reseated. You know, I think if we just talk about it and preach about it and teach about it, but we don't ever do it, then we don't make much progress. So I apologize if I offended any of you in the way you were taught to minister healing. You can do it any way you want to. I'm just saying, if you read the book of Acts, that's what you'll see. Some of you are still saying, I don't believe that. I'm going to go back. I know. The closest, I'll tell you, the closest instance you have in the book of Acts, wow, I've got 10 minutes left. I haven't even got to page one of my notes. The closest you'll have in the book of Acts is when Peter goes into Tabitha and she's dead. What does he do? He turns around, he goes over into the corner, and he kneels down, and he prays. What's he doing? He's not praying for her. He's getting direction. He's hearing what he's supposed to do. He's watched Jesus do this. He says, I only do what I see my Father do. I only say what I hear my Father say. Peter kneels down, and he gets direction. He goes over there, and he doesn't pray for her. He says, Tabitha, arise. Takes her by the hand, picks her up. Give her something to eat. Acts chapter 3. They're walking to the prayer meeting in the morning. This is not after they get out of the prayer meeting. Oh, I'm all full. I'm pumped up. Oh, man, what a prayer meeting. I got faith now. No, they're on the way to the prayer meeting. And they see the guy that's been there for 18 years. Evidently, Jesus walked through there. He didn't pray for him. Why didn't Jesus heal him? He had the power. He had the authority. But he didn't have the direction. You see, the only reason we don't go in the hospitals and clear out all the hospitals, because we have the authority, we have the power. The only reason we don't do that is because if we were to do that without the instructions of the Holy Spirit, it's called a work of iniquity. Have we not cast out devils in your name? Sorry, I didn't tell you to do that. That's iniquity. That's the difference between a sin and an iniquity. You don't just do it because you have the authority and power. You do it because you're tuned into the voice of the Holy Spirit. He's the one giving you the directions. He knows who's ready to receive that and who's not ready to receive that. Your will cannot overtake someone else's will. You can't make somebody get healed if they're not ready to receive that. Okay, I know I just crossed the line for somebody, but you know, that'll answer a lot of questions for you. It'll help you. All right, I've got 8 minutes left. What can I do? Not much. Let me tell you another story. Huh? Yeah, I got to tell you another story. I got some great notes here. Oh, man. Okay. Tomorrow morning, do I get to preach tomorrow morning? Tomorrow morning. One of the things the Lord's taught Cheeky and I is to, when we go to a restaurant, which we do quite often, how many of you go to restaurants to eat once in a while? Okay, you know, the same thing happens every time you go in. You get a seat. Sooner or later, a waiter or waitress will come and they'll hand you a menu. They'll give you a little bit to look over the menu, and then they'll come back and ask you what you want to order. Anybody have any different experience than that? Isn't that the way it works in a restaurant? Okay. So they come back and ask what you're going to order. And what we've learned to do as an entrance point of the kingdom into somebody's life that we don't know usually is we'll say, oh, by the way, we just placed our order. When you bring our food back, it's just our pattern. We pray. We give thanks to God for the food. And we also want to pray for you. Is there something that you would like for us to pray with you about? It always shocks them. And sometimes, rarely, but sometimes they'll come back and say, no, nothing. But because there's this space of time while the food's getting cooked, you know, we're praying, Holy Spirit's working. It's been amazing. We had waiters and waitresses pull up a chair next to us and just start unloading stuff, you know. Well, I remember Iris. I can't tell you the whole story, but I was going to take Cheeky out to her favorite Mexican food restaurant. And I said, you know, you've been working hard. She was working on editing my book. And you've been working hard. I want to just bless you. Where do you want? Here's your favorite place. Let's go. Yeah, let's go. That's great. We go there, and it's no longer a Mexican food restaurant. It's been turned into a hamburger bar. That's weird. So, okay, number two, favorite place. We drive over to that place. It's not there. It's been razed to the ground. They're putting in a bypass from the highway. It's not even there. Like, this is weird. Our two favorite places are gone, and we just ate at these places in the last month. They're gone. So you know, where do we go? We go to the next place, Cafe Laredo. Okay, that's nice. Let's try it. We hadn't been there. Go in there. And this young lady comes to us, and she hands the menu. Same drill. And she, as we're ordering the food, Cheeky says, by the way, Iris, you know, they always wear a badge. You don't have to have a word of knowledge for that. They always wear a badge. By the way, Iris, we're going to be praying for our food when you bring it back. Is there something we can pray with you about? And she went, she's like, why would you say that to me? And she took off. And I thought, oh, we got one of these Northwestern liberals moved down from Oregon. Going to be filing suit, you know. It's either going to be bad or really good or something. She took off. And I thought, okay, well, let's pray. And so in a minute, we see her. She hooks up with one of the other waitresses, and they're talking, and they go back into the back room, and then, oh, this looks really bad. We might get kicked out before we even get to eat. That'd be three restaurants in a row. Boom. What's going on here? So in a little bit, the manager comes by. He just kind of walks by our table, looks, kind of walks by. Doesn't say anything. He just kind of walks by. Wow, this, I know she's talking. A little bit, she comes back, and she says, I just have to apologize for how I responded. She said, I just have to tell you that today has been the worst day I've had since I've been working at this place. She said, I've been so sick all day, I could barely work. I could barely serve. And just a minute ago, before y'all came in, my manager told me, Iris, go to the restroom, get yourself together, or go home. And she said, I went to the restroom, and I just said, God, if you're real and if you love me, would you send somebody to pray for me? I'm telling you. Is that right? She says, I come out of the bathroom and you're there. You're in my area. And you said, is there anything we can pray with you about? She said, I about lost it. So we took her by hand. I took her left hand. Cheeky took her right hand. We just prayed for her. She comes back a little bit later and she says, no, wasn't her first. It's the manager. Manager comes back. We're eating our food now. Manager comes back and says, what did you say to Iris? And I'm still thinking, we might be in trouble. What did you say to Iris? Well, you know, she wasn't feeling well, so we just prayed for her. She says, that's awesome.
He says, she's back there talking on the phone to her parents right now, telling them that something's happened. She's totally well. He says, how do you do that? How do you do that? We said, well, it's just simple. It's Jesus. We just ask him to come. He wants to heal people. He says, wow, it must feel so good to be able to give that away to people. People are hungry. People are broken. You have the power of the King living in you, and he wants out. He wants out. He wants to flow through you. And there's some simple ways to hook up with people, just like that. You go to the restaurant today. Hey, we're going to be praying over our food a little bit. What can we pray with you about? What's going on in your life? Most of them are in college. They don't have enough money to get through. They're burning the candle at both ends. All this kind of stuff. Broken relationships. We've prayed for a number of young ladies. They're carrying a baby. They're pregnant. Out of wedlock. Their whole, you know, the guy that's gotten them pregnant is not with them anymore. All that kind of stuff. Man, the door's wide open for the presence of the King to come in and just love on them. Here's what I want you to hear. What we've already heard this morning. The gifts of the Spirit, the working of miracles, the working of power is not about you to make a name for yourself or you're launching into your ministry or you somehow getting your identity. The ministry of the gifts of the Spirit is just God letting you in on who he be and what he does. And that is he loves to love people back into wholeness. And he gives us the opportunity to be a part of that. So I say, well, I have the gift of discerning of spirits. No, you don't. What I know about textually, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, none of those gifts belong to us. Those gifts, the key word there is phanerosis. It's the same word where we get phantom. They come, they work, and then they leave. Kind of like the Holy Spirit worked through the prophets in the Old Testament. He doesn't give you the gift of discerning of spirits. He uses you through that. If you're open, Paul says, man, you can all prophesy, right? So what does it mean to covet the best gifts? Well, the best gifts, prophecy, the best gifts. No, the best gifts, whatever's needed at the time. If you're ministering to somebody that's in stage 4 cancer, guess what? They don't just need a prophetic word. I mean, that's okay. But what they need is a working of miracles, the gifts of healing. So you say, Lord, you said whatever's the best gift of the time, this is the best gift. I just ask you to use me any way you want to use me. Partner with him. Now, I have a word I want to share just before I sit down. This is, didn't get to any of my notes. But I want to share this with you because I saw this yesterday. It's the picture in John 11 of Lazarus. And Jesus receives word that Lazarus is sick. You know the story? Lazarus was a close friend. Lazarus, Martha, Mary. And Martha sends message to Jesus. He's in another town. Sends message to him. Lazarus, listen to this now. Lazarus, whom you love, is sick. You hear the manipulation in there? Okay, Jesus, if you really love him, it's time to get over here. Jesus is not moved by that. He stays 2 more days. Tells his disciples, Lazarus is asleep. They said, well, if he's just asleep, he'll get better. No, you don't get it. He's dead, Jesus says. But it's time for us to go, that the Lord may, that God may be glorified. He goes, and as he's getting, before he even gets to the town, what happens? You know the story. First, Martha runs out and meets him and says, Lord, if you had only been here, Lazarus would not have died. Hear the expectation. She sends word back to Mary. Mary runs out the house, runs and meets Jesus. Same thing. Lord, if you had only been here on time, the way we expected you to do it, the common sense way is you pray for people before they die, right? Jesus said, no. I do whatever the Father tells me to do. Catch this. Before Jesus gets there, they're disappointed with the fact that he doesn't meet their expectation by being there soon enough. But now that he's there, he says, roll away the stone. Now listen, the same two ladies. Oh, no, 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 Lord. He's stinking already. It's been 4 days. See, when we think he's late, we're disappointed that he's late. Then when he shows up, but he wants to do it a different way than we're used to, we're disappointed with that too. Here's a word for this church, and I want to read it the way I heard it. This is a season. I'm not going to say a year, because sometimes a year in the things of God is not a 365-day period. This is a season that this church is entering into when you will stop asking the Lord to do it a certain way, and you'll say, Lord,
however you want to work. Just fill us with your love. Use us and come and work. You're never too late and you're never too early. Would you just close your eyes with me? Let's just say that. Would you join with me? If that resonates in your heart at all, would you just say this with me? Lord, this is a year when I'm going to stop asking you to do a certain way. And I just say, Lord, however you want to work, however you want to come, if you want to come in my favorite Mexican food restaurant, come. If you want to come in my workplace, come. If you want to work in the school, come. If you want to work in the church, please come. But however you want to come, we ask you to come. Love through us, and may the people around us feel your love. We declare, Lord, you're never too early, and you're never too late. You're always right on time. Thank you for your love for us. And everybody said together, amen. Bless you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise God. At this time, I'm going to take an offering. And the reason I'm taking it now instead of later is because I believe that after our last speaker, that the glory of the Lord is going to really fall in this place. And I just don't want to stop to take an offering at that time, okay? So let us bow our heads in prayer. Father, I just thank you for this awesome time together. And I ask that you would bless the sower and that you would bless those that can't even give at this time, Lord. I thank you for your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.